Hello everyone, my name is Aditya Shenoy from Brainy Things. In this video, we are going to develop a console game that is Flappy Birds. Before we get into the details of how to develop a console game like Flappy Birds, I would like to make a statement beforehand. That is, the code that I am going to write in this video is completely unplanned and I have not tested this code before recording this video. This is because I want you to understand the thought process that goes into the logic development of any application or game. And as this code is completely unplanned, I will surely get some errors. I hope that I will be able to explain you how to locate errors and how to debug those errors. So without any delay, let's get started. First, we will import the curses library. Curses library is used to make console applications or games. For Linux and macOS users, I believe that this curses library comes pre-installed in the Python package itself. But for Windows users like me, we need to install an extra module, Windows-curses. The command that needs to be run to install this package will be displayed at the screen right now. Once you install this, you can import curses library normally. Next, we will use the curses.wrapper function that will do the initial setup of the console for us. Then we will define the callback function that we have passed in the wrapper function, that is main. This wrapper function will take a parameter of screen object that we can use to add or remove game elements. Before we add any game elements to the screen, let's first check whether the curses library or the screen object is working correctly or not. For that, I will use the screen.addString function. It will take three parameters, y coordinate, x coordinate, and a string that needs to be printed at these coordinates. Whenever we make any changes to the screen, we need to refresh the screen by using screen.refresh function. And to be able to see those changes, we need to freeze the screen. For that, I will import time library. From this time library, I will use the time.sleep function with a delay of 5 seconds. If we run this program, we can see that the string is getting printed at y equal to 1 and x equal to 0. The screen will wait for 5 seconds and the application will be closed. We can remove these lines as they were just for debugging purposes. Before adding any game elements to the screen, we need to know what screen dimensions we are working with. For that, we will get the values of height and width by using screen.getMaxYX function. Next, we will draw a rectangle on the console to represent the game arena. I am unable to find the rectangle function in the suggestions that are provided by my code editor. So I will open my browser and search how to draw rectangle in curses. And before clicking any of the search links, I am getting my answer as the title of the search result over here, that is curses.textpad.rectangle. As you can see that this function takes five parameters, first being the screen object on which we need to draw the rectangle. The next two parameters are the top left coordinates of the rectangle. we will pass a value of 3 to this function because we want a blank line at the top, then a line to display score or other text like game over, and another blank line below this. But wait, before instead of passing hard-coded value 3 to this function, we can declare a constant margin equal to 3. I'm using the all caps naming convention because this is a constant variable. Now we can pass this constant variable to our rectangle function. For the next two coordinates, which are the bottom right coordinates of the rectangle, we need to take an account of the height and the width of the screen. So for y, it will be height minus margin, and for x coordinate, it will be width minus margin. As we are changing the screen by drawing a rectangle on the console, we again need to refresh the screen. And this time, instead of waiting for a fixed amount of time, we will wait for the user's input by using screen.getCharacter function. Before we add any other lines of code, let's first see whether this code is working or not. As you can see, we are getting a lot of lines of error over here, but our main focus should be in the last few lines of this code. The third last line indicates the file name that was causing the error and the line number which was actually causing the error in this file. The second last line here indicates the entire line that was present at this line number, and the last line indicates the error message. Here we have an attribute error, that is, we are having a problem with some attribute of some object. Here the object is curses and the attribute is textpad. Module curses has no attribute textpad. But wait, we have just seen on the browser that curses has a attribute of textpad. So why our program is not able to understand this? Because we are not importing the submodule textpad in our program. So to resolve this, we will import curses.textpad. But as we are using only one function from this submodule, we will use from keyword instead of import keyword. From curses.textpad import rectangle. And we can remove this curses.textpad.prefix because we have imported the function itself. And now if we run the program again, we can see a nice looking rectangle on the console. But we have a problem over here. If you can see at the bottom left corner, we can see a cursor blinking over there. Ideally, in any program or console application or game, we don't want this cursor blinking on the console. So to disable this, we will use a function of curses library, that is curses.curse_set, and we will pass a value of 0 to it. That is, we want to disable the cursor. Now if we run the program again, we see that the cursor is now not visible. We can remove these two lines. We will define a Flappy Bird character that will be a string to represent the body of the Flappy Bird. We will represent it using the @ character. Next, we will start an infinite loop, that is while true. This will be our game loop, which will continuously take user input and update the game for us. We will calculate the coordinates of the Flappy Bird in this loop. For y coordinate, it will be at the vertically middle point of the screen. So we will pass height divided by 2. Here I'm using a double slash, that is integer division, because we want this values of y and x to be integer values instead of floating values. And for x coordinate, it will be at the 1/4 of the width, so that we can have so that we can have 3/4 of the remaining width for the obstacles of the game. Now we can display the Flappy Bird at the above coordinates using the add string function y, x, Flappy Bird, and we will refresh the screen. We will again wait for the user's input. I'm adding a temporary break statement over here because we are working with an infinite loop, which will end when the game over condition occurs. As we have not added this condition yet, so we will have this iteration, this loop to run for only one iteration for now. Now if we run the program again, we see that the Flappy Bird is being printed at the correct position, that is 1/4 of the width and vertically at the middle point. Now we can start working with the pipe obstacles. For storing the pipe, we will use an empty list initially. I'm running the program again to see where we should start rendering this pipe. I think we should start rendering the pipe from the middle of the screen, and then we can space it like this. We will calculate the coordinates of the pipe, that is y, x. The y coordinate will start from the top margin and the x will be at half the width. I am moving this code down because we have defined margin equal to 3 over here. And I will add a plus 1 over here because we want this pipe to be rendered inside the margin, and at y equal to margin we have the rectangle being drawn, so we want this pipes to be inside the top margin. Let's display only one pipe to see if this position of the pipe is correct or not. So we will again use screen.addString y, x, and I will display the pipe obstacle using a pipe character, no puns intended. We are refreshing the screen in the game loop itself, so we don't need to add those statement. If we run the program, we can see that the pipe is displayed at the correct position. Now we need to have randomly located gaps between pipes so that Flappy Bird can pass through them. For that, I will import the random module. We will start a while loop that will iterate for all values of x until it reaches the rightmost margin, that is width minus margin. We will randomly initialize the topmost y coordinate of the gap between pipes for each of the x coordinate. So that will be gap underscore start. And we will use the random.randint function. We want these values to be between the top margin and the bottom margin. I will add a plus 1 and minus 1. Because we don't want again to include the margins itself, and we want this gap to be inside the margins itself. Now I will declare one more constant, that is gap width. That will be a constant again initialized with 3. This will be the vertical gap width that the pipes will have through which the Flappy Bird should pass through. We will start a for loop to iterate for all values of y between top margin and bottom margin. We will check if the value of y falls in the range of the gap start and gap start plus width. Gap start plus gap width plus 1. Inside this if condition, we want the pipes to be not rendered. So we will add a not keyword so that we can write the rendering statements over here. And for rendering, we can use screen.addString. Use this y and x values. Now we are initializing values of y using the for loop itself. So we don't need this y value anymore. So we will use this y value and x value and display the pipe using the pipe character. I'm adding a temporary break statement over here because we will see whether this while loop is working for at least one iteration or not. As you can see that we are getting one more extra gap than we actually require. So this was responsible because of this if condition, because this was preventing them to be not rendering. Yes, this plus one. I don't know why I've added this plus one in the first hand itself. So gap start and gap start plus gap width. That is, we will have a gap width amount of spaces between those two pipes. And now if we run the program again, we will get a gap of 3 width. As we are initializing the gap start over here using the random module, we should always run this program multiple times to catch boundary conditions like this. As you can see that this gap start has been initialized just above the bottom margin, and there is only one gap available for the Flappy Bird to pass through, and we don't want this to happen. So while initializing the gap start, we should also take an account of the gap width variable over here. So the final value that we need to be able to assign to this gap start should be height minus margin minus gap start. Gap width. So that we will always have a gap width amount of space between those two pipes. Now, if we run multiple times this program, we will always get a 3 gap width. Now we can remove this break statement. I'm declaring one more constant, that is inter gap width. We will initialize it to 3 itself for now, and we will increment this x's value to this constant value, inter gap width. This will be the horizontal spacing between those two pipes. Now if we run the program again, we can see that we are getting equally spaced pipes in our game, each having 3 width of space, but these pipes are spaced too close to each other, and Flappy Bird could not pass through gaps like this. So we need to increase the gap over here. So let's try with a value of 10. Still this gap seems to be very low. Let's try a value of 15 maybe. Yeah, I think this gap is reasonable for the Flappy Bird to pass through. Now we can start storing the information of this pipe inside the list that we have created. So while we are storing this information, while we are rendering this pipe over here, we can also store it using this pipe.append. We will store the x value and the gap start, because these values are the minimum information that we will require to recreate the whole pipe again. And this line is not dependent on the y. This line is not dependent on the y variable, so we can move this line outside the for loop. And we can move this section of rendering of the pipes inside the game loop, because the rendering of the pipes will happen continuously when the game will start, and this section where the initial pipes are generated will happen only once. Even though some more pipes will be generated afterwards, but this initial pipes will generate only once before the game starts. So we will move this inside the game loop, and now we need this x and gap start, and we have this information stored in the pipes list. So we will use the stored information, that is x and gap start, and inside this for loop we will have this is pipe. So inside this for loop we will have the rendering of the pipes, and in future we will update the pipe structure so that the game will proceed. Let us check if this moving of the code from outside to inside has changed the logic or not. No, it has not. So it is still 15 width, and yeah, the code has not been altered anymore. Ideally, in a game, we want to capture user inputs, but if the user has not entered anything, the game should proceed with its logic instead of waiting indefinitely. Let us check on the internet how to remove the delay in the curses library. How to remove delay in curses. And again, without clicking on this, I'm getting my answer, that is the function that is used for this. So we are using no delay function over here. We will add this to this initial setup over here, screen dot no delay. We will pass a value of 1 because we want to enable the no delay functionality. Also, we need to specify the timeout. That is, if there is no delay over here, so for how much time the program will wait for the user input before proceeding with its logic. So for that, we will use screen.timeout function. We will set it to 150 milliseconds. And if we run the program again, you can see that the program briefly waited for the user's input and then closed it because we have added a break statement over here after the getCharacter function. And this break function caused this infinite loop to break and the program was terminated. So we will remove this break statement and we will store the key that was pressed by the user. And if the user has not pressed anything, this key will take a value of -1 and we will display it at the top left corner of the screen. So screen.addString, for top left it is 0,0, and we will just print the string representation of this key at the top left corner of the screen. We are already refreshing the screen. Okay, let's see. As you can see, I'm not pressing anything, so it is showing a -1 sign over here. Now if I press some number, you can see that the code is updated. But wait, you can see a -10 over here. That is not -10, that is actually -1 only, but this 0 digit is due to the previous 3 digit number that was being displayed. So this -1 is just 2 characters and it is not overlaying the previous code properly. But we are able to capture user input by this function. And we are stuck in an infinite loop, so we need to close the terminal because we have not added any break condition over here. So before proceeding with any other code, we will add the breaking condition over here. That is, if key equal to 27. This 27 is the key code for escape key. And we will break out of the game loop over here. And to resolve the overlaying problem, we will format this key to be say 5 characters long, so that each character will have the same width and so they will be able to overlay each other properly. Now we need to start the terminal again, and you can see that the character is being printed, the key code is being printed with the 5 width character, and if we press anything, it is printed correctly, and if we press escape, the program will close. We will remove this debugging line. And we will check if the user has pressed say enter key. Curses dot key enter. So curses library has the constants predefined inside them so that you don't need to remember the key codes like this. If the user has pressed the enter key, we need to change the Y coordinate of the Flappy Bird so that it can move up. And I'm moving this line outside the game loop because this initial calculation of the coordinates will happen only once before the game starts. I will rename this to Flappy Y and Flappy X so that we don't get confused by the other coordinates like over here. And if the user has pressed the enter key, we need to change the Y coordinate so that it goes up. Let's see if the code is working or not. Oh, the Flappy Bird has moved to this region. Okay, this logical error is easy to resolve because there is only one line responsible to render the Flappy Bird. So let's see by pressing the escape key, and yes, we have not changed all the occurrences of X and Y to Flappy Y and Flappy X. So now let's run the program again. The Flappy Bird is printed at the right position, but even though I'm pressing the enter key, the Flappy Bird is not changing its position. Let's see by running this program again. I know that this running of program again will not change anything, but this is just a programmer's way to debug when he is unable to understand what is happening. So apologies. Okay, so maybe there is some problem with the enter key. So let's rename it to key up, because there is no restriction of which key to use. So let's run the program again. And if I press the up key, the Flappy Bird is going down. Also, there is one more problem, that the previously rendered, that is the previous Flappy Bird's position, is still retaining the Flappy Bird character. That is, we need to delete the previous character before moving the Flappy Bird. And we also need to change this direction so that the Flappy Bird goes up instead of going down. So to change this direction, we need to change this to minus equal to 1, because if we decrease the Flappy Y, the Flappy Bird will go up. And before we change the coordinate, we will delete the previously rendered Flappy Bird in its old coordinate with a space character. That is, a space will be rendered at the original position, and then the coordinate will be changed. Now if we run the program again, we can see that the Flappy Bird is going up, and also it is deleting the previously rendered Flappy Bird character, but it can go up and outside the screen and the program crashes. But the code is working fine. Now let's add a else condition so that we can write the logic where if the user has not pressed anything, so what to do. In this case, we will increment the Flappy Y's coordinate so that like the gravity is working on the Flappy Bird. Now if we run the program again, we can see that the Flappy Bird is going down when I when I'm not pressing anything, but we are still having this problem of not deleting the previous character. So I will copy this line and move it to over here. We are having exactly same lines in the if and else condition. So we can move this line outside the if condition and remove the duplicate line. So this will delete the character and this section will change the coordinate. As you can see that the Flappy Bird is going down or up based on the user input. Now as you can see that the Flappy Bird is moving correctly. We will complete this code in the next video. We will add the game arena border restriction to avoid this crashing of the game, and we will add more pipes, and we will see how to tweak the game to change its difficulty. We will also move this pipes towards the Flappy Bird. To summarize this video, we have seen the functionalities of the curses library, like the add string and various other functions that we have used over here. We have added the initialization section over here that initializes some initial obstacles, the character, draws the main arena, declares some constant. And then we have a game loop over here, inside which we will render the pipes, we will render the Flappy Bird character, then we will refresh the screen, and then we will capture the user input, and based on the user input we will proceed with the game logic. If you end up liking this video, please give this video a like, comment any feedbacks that you have for this video or this channel. You can also comment future topics for this channel. Subscribe to this channel to see more programming related videos. It is free and you can always unsubscribe if you want. Share this video with your friends who would like to develop some hands-on project like this, or anyone who are interested in programming. All the code that I show in this channel is present in my GitHub repository, whose link is in the description. I'll see you in the next video. Take care. Bye.